just an extension of Pakistan's terrorism. In a book that has hit the stands globally, America's first black president, Barack Obama, gives an account of his presidential journey. After the respectful description of India's former prime minister, Barack Obama's A Promised Land also describes the daring Abbottabad raid that killed Al-Qaeda chief Osama bin Laden. And what can be termed as a major embarrassment for Pakistan, the former President Obama had ruled against involving Pakistan in the Osama bin Laden raid, as it was an open secret that certain elements inside Pakistan's military and intelligence service maintained links to the Taliban and even Al-Qaeda. These are the words used by the 44th President of the United States of America, Barack Obama himself. The blow-by-blow account of the Abbottabad raid describes how the world's most wanted terrorist was captured and killed on May 2nd in 2011. As per his book, the top-secret operation was opposed by then-Defense Secretary Robert Gates. Also in the opposition was Obama's former Vice President and now President-elect Joe Biden. Obama has also described the various options of killing bin Laden after it became increasingly clear that the elusive Al-Qaeda chief was living in a safe hideout on the outskirts of a Pakistani military cantonment in Abbottabad. After the successful raid, Obama made a number of phone calls, the toughest of which was to then President of Pakistan, Asif Ali Zardari. And Obama also mentioned that, to his surprise, President Zardari expressed congratulations and support, recalling how his wife Benazir Bhutto had been killed by extremists. Osama bin Laden, the world's most wanted terrorist, was the chief of Al-Qaeda, the terror group which had carried out 9/11 attacks on the Twin Towers in New York, killing nearly 3,000 people back in 2001. And the description that we have just enlisted, by the way, has been described by the president himself in his latest book. For more details, let's quickly go across to former High Commissioner and former Information Advisor at Prime Minister's Office, Ambassador G. Parthasarathy, who's joining us live from Delhi this hour. Thank you, Ambassador, for joining us. Now, how do you view the description of Osama's killing by President Obama in his book? Is it a final vindication of Pakistan's role in sponsoring and aiding terror?
Well, it certainly has been a vindication for some time, because we knew, at least in government here in Delhi, that the Osama bin Laden was being shielded by the CIA, by the ISI, the Inter-Services Intelligence of Pakistan, which carries out all such activities, and that they had hidden him there with the approval of the then president, General Musharraf. And the American CIA found out where he was. It was also a very well-conducted operation. But as far as the consequences are concerned, yes, Pakistan has been labeled as now as a supporter of international terrorism. Otherwise, there was no reason for them to have him. But also, what is of interest is that now the statement's coming out.
Right.
That it is not just Taliban, but also Al-Qaeda who are operating in Pakistan, in Afghanistan. And quite obviously, nothing happens there without the CIA's, the ISI's knowledge.
Right. And since you mentioned ISI's knowledge, a French member of the European Parliament has now therefore called for real financial or trade sanctions against Ankara, Islamabad, Kuwait City and even Doha. What sort of collateral damage could this mean specifically for Pakistan? And I'm also going to talk about terror financing, but in a bit, I'd like you to answer this.
Well, the basic thing is that European aid is what keeps Pakistan going. They're broke in financial terms. They've gotten into a debt trap with China, having to repay a lot for projects which China has undertaken under the China-Pakistan Economic Corridor. Incidentally, the maximum benefit of that goes to China rather than to Pakistan, and Pakistan pays. That's an interesting relationship. So I think they have tied themselves up. And this is the Europeans are not going to stop here. It will come in the European Parliament. And the whole question of aid to Pakistan, why should Europe be dishing out hundreds of millions of euro, which are all dollars, to Pakistan if this is what it's up to in European lands.
Precisely, Ambassador. The European Union has continued to provide it with substantial support. In the last 10 years, 600 million euro had been given to Pakistan as aid. And on October 6 itself, this year, 150 million euro further support was announced to help with the COVID-19 crisis. Is there even any accountability coming in from Pakistan in terms of how and where this financial aid is being allocated, or how is it being disbursed?
Well, really what it is done is to spend it on things which they should have been spending their own money on. And that has gone into all sorts of activities, including terrorism. And therefore, the Europeans are stuck with this. And the other thing is Pakistan has now been asking for debt rescheduling for a number of countries. I don't think the European Union should agree. Mm. I also, or anybody else should agree for that matter. And I think as long as Pakistan is known to be sponsoring terrorism, and Barack Obama has said, or what happened when they killed Osama bin Laden, right at the, you know, that was right at the heart of the most major cantonment city in Pakistan, which is also the headquarters of where they train their officers. It's the training school is there. So there is no question of their not knowing. Osama himself was living in a building pretty much adjacent to the largest training school for officers in Pakistan.
Right. Fair enough, Ambassador. On the last note, referring to terror financing, FATF had said that Pakistan had not met 6 of the 27 points. One of them included, quote-unquote, meaningful prosecution. And that was with regards to hardliners and terrorists who are, of course, in cahoot with the army. Is Pakistan even capable of addressing this aspect of terror financing, especially when it comes to other radicals in the country?
Pakistan is capable, but it does not want to and pretends it is not capable. I mean, it wants to, what it borrows, it lends, it has to repay. And therefore, the cases have to be followed up vigorously. What I cannot understand is here you have the Pakistanis abusing France and Imran Khan sending out letters to all and sundry blaming France for not acting against a person who later beheaded the author, the teacher. And the fellow who killed him, when he was shot, Pakistan gets this outrage. I mean, what is shocking? They don't expect any outrage about the action of the terrorist who beheaded a French citizen. And really, I'm glad we stood by France. France is a friendly country, mm-hmm. and we stood by them. You can't go around having people behead the nation, the citizens of a country where you have taken refuge as a refugee. And been given the right to live. So France justifiably is angry that in return for generosity it gets beheading. And Pakistan and Turkey lend us sort of justify that by saying that he should not have been executed, the man concerned.
Right.
So it's ridiculous.
And perhaps
I think the final word is any nation which lends support to terrorism. And Pakistan, there is enough proof of the FATF to keep them hanging, deserves to get sanctions.
Mm-hmm. And perhaps that's reason enough for the global community to now take a more stringent stand when it comes to addressing the issue of terrorism, especially emanating from Pakistan. Having said that, thank you so much, Ambassador Parthasarathy, for joining our broadcast with your precious inputs.